I remember Star Wars came out when I was in elementary school, and one of the key things that I remember my friends talking about was, this is a really cool creature. The point that would always be brought up would be that, wouldn't it be great if we actually saw that move?
In the original movie, in order to get dewbacks and things into the movie, we built a large rubber mannequin, really, that we were able to move around from set to set. He had a big stick in his head that somebody could sit alongside and move the head back and forth, and that was about as much movement as I could get out of it. You know, it was a very crude thing. I tried, again, to get as many different kinds of spaceships, robots, vehicles, animals as I could possibly fit into the movie. And I was always very frustrated about the fact that I couldn't get the dewbacks to actually move or do anything. They were just basically big rubber statues.
What did you like better, Jedi or The Empire Strikes Back?
Empire.
Blasphemy.
All Jedi had was a bunch of Muppets.
Boring conversation anyway.
Who need that? No, no, no! Alawa! Who need that?
Hey, Star Wars fans, and welcome to Boring Conversation Anyway. This is Chris, one of your hosts, and I'm always joined by my good friend Thor. Thor, how you doing?
Doing okay.
All right, great.
As always.
Today is episode 142, and it's one of our special episodes because we're doing the special edition the full year. Trying to go episode by episode, so this is episode 3. And today we are talking about the documentary, The Anatomy of a Dewback.
Yes.
So, you watched it.
I did.
Watched it a couple times. We foolishly thought that we could just watch it and then talk about it and realize it's
super technical.
Yes. And deep. There's a lot of stuff in it.
Yeah.
Now, to talk about how this came out was, it came out on StarWars.com in 97 at 5-minute intervals, which makes so much sense. Because if you take this in 5-minute chunks, it really is a lot easier to digest than watching this whole thing.
Right, and I was actually curious about where it originated from, because obviously I owned like the VHS tapes, and they weren't on there.
Right, right.
And we watched it on Disney Plus. You can find it on Disney Plus on the special features for A New Hope. But yeah, the internet, it's just so funny, because like, oh my god, there's no way I had a computer that would have been able to watch this in 1997.
Right, right, okay, yeah.
And like, we had pretty good computers when I was a kid, but...
Yeah, I didn't see this one. I saw this one, I believe, when it was released on digital, they actually had it as one of the ones. Yeah.
I feel like in 97, I would have had it buffering for like 5, 6, 7 hours, just for that 5 minutes of them talking about you.
So you dial up? Yeah.
Yeah.
I mean, 99, waiting for the trailer for Phantom Menace.
Right. So that gives perspective on how early the internet was.
I hit the load button, drove college 25 minutes away, did 2 classes, came back. Still wasn't 100% downloaded when I got back home.
Yeah.
And it was crazy. And I figured if anybody picked up the phone, too, it would kill it, I think, too. So that was tricky.
So.
Yeah. That's a long time ago. But why are we doing this? Why are we doing this? We're doing this because I really believe that the dewback, this whole thing about him wanting to replace the dewback, is what causes whole special edition stuff to go into motion.
Okay, yeah.
All right? Talk about it. Because... the reason is that Fox reaches out to George and say, hey, look, the 20-year anniversary is coming up. What do you want to do? You want to do a re-release? He goes, sure, I do. And the first thing that I want to do is I want to get the film looking better because it's old, it's grainy, we got to clean it. Okay. But while they're cleaning it, he's like, I want to change the dewback. I hate that the dewback can't walk. So I really believe that that was the first one. And he's like, oh, if I can do that, then let's go do this. And then if we're doing this, let's go do this and let's do that. So we're going to dive into it. This whole 26-minute documentary is essentially how to put a digital creature or object into an existing shot. And it's a lot of work.
It's a lot of work. I mean, that's kind of the beautiful thing about it is that I'm not saying everything was as much work as the dewback, But it really gives you a perspective on how much work the special editions were.
Exactly.
And, like, that only happens because George could do it. It's just hard to imagine spending this much time and effort for, like, any other film. Like, we've talked about that before, of, like, what other films can you think of that were, like, touched up this much, you know, and re-released and such?
You know, it's a great question, because, like,
or which franchises could deserve it, you know?
And also, too, I'm just thinking about, in this time period, what did we get to see? And I could be missing something, but the biggest gold standard for digital at that point is Jurassic Park, right?
Right.
And I consumed everything about Jurassic Park behind the scenes. They went over a couple things. Not like this. You know what I mean? They showed the shot of already made dinosaurs in a skeleton, and, like, okay, we could do that. And then the shot that made Steven Spielberg say we can do this is they do it in the bright sunlight.
Right.
And that's what's like, okay, that convinces me, let's go and do it. I didn't tell you how they did it. Mm-hmm. This tells you how they do everything.
That's always been crazy. Lucasfilm.
Right, exactly.
They used to, at least, love showing how the magic was made.
I was going to say that. Not anymore. I mean, we do get those things on Disney Plus.
Yeah, where they just talk about how great they are, and that's it. Yeah.
Yeah, all right. All right, so let's dive in. The first person we meet here in this story is Tom Kennedy. He's a producer, and he's going to let us know some information about sequencing.
On a typical film, when ILM's working on shots, we may have anywhere from 50 to sometimes 1,200 shots in a film. It helps not to just give them numbers, because it's a little hard to keep track that you're working on shot 437. How is that different from shot 512? So instead, usually they're broken down by sequences. So in Star Wars, we took the Tatooine Dune sequence, and the first three shots that came in were TD1 for Tatooine Dune. TD1, TD2, and TD3.
Okay. That's pretty easy to understand.
No, I'm already lost.
So, well, the sequence is TD is the dunes, Tatooine dunes. So they're talking about when, in the original Star Wars, the stormtroopers find the droid part and realize the droids came out of the capsule, right? So they want to replace the Dewback. And they find out that, okay, they've got it now that TD3 is the shot that they can replace the Dewback in. And we're going to hear from David Tanaka, which you guys already heard in the intro. Mm-hmm. And he works for ILM as well, and he's a visual editor. And he's going to tell us that really we're not actually dealing with live action, which blew my mind. So listen to this one.
If you look at the shot as it existed in the original Star Wars, it's kind of buffered by two transition points. I think what happens is you have a clockwise wipe that goes from a sandcrawler shot into the Tatooine Dunes shot.
Someone was in the pod. The tracks go off in this direction. Look, sir, droids.
And then you have an iris out shot back to another miniature photography shot. So right away, we realized that we weren't dealing necessarily with live action. What we were dealing with was an element that was at one time or another brought down to an optical house, recomped to add the transition. So what was in the movie was not the original footage.
That's crazy. Because George loved doing those kind of wipes. That's what he's talking about, the wipes. You know, like, so you go from one scene to another. Well, once you do that and stamp it on there, you don't have the original film. Mm-hmm. So, all right, they need to go find TD3. They actually have to go find the actual film that they shot with, because they can't use what they have, because it's an optical. So it's going to screw up everything, right? So, T.M. Christopher, which you know the name, he's an editor. He did the editor for all three special editions.
Yep.
And he edited Young Indiana Jones, the TV movie, and the series. Mm. So he's the guy who does all the special editions and he edits them.
Also a great mustache.
Yes.
Yeah.
He's like, hey, guess what, guys? I have all the film here. We don't have TD3. It's missing. So now they have to go find TD3. So they go down to the archives, and Tim Fox, he's a film archivist, and he's going to go look for this. And here's what he has to say. And George is going to come in with Tim to talk a little bit too, so you see what's going on.
Here we are in the Lucasfilm Archives, which houses all the material shot for every Lucasfilm production, beginning with THX 1138. This is where the search for the trooper in the desert sequence began, starting with the Star Wars work print material, which Tom Christopher, the editor, had already removed into his cutting room. There he was able to identify which elements he thought would be useful in remaking the effect, and it was my job after that to start a search for the negative.
I started out as an editor, so to me, you know, saving the film is what the whole process is about, and so I've saved all my films, I've saved all the negative, I've saved everything, partly because I'm a pack rat and partly because as an editor, I just don't want to throw those things out because I never know when I might want to go back into it again.
To look for the negative, I had to come here to our cold storage vault, which houses all the negative for Willow, indie movies, Empire, and finally we get to the Star Wars area, which is where I had to go digging for the Trooper in the Desert negative. So what happened is we went through all these boxes. We were not able to find the one that was actually used to make the effect.
All right. So they don't have it.
Mm-hmm.
So now Lucasfilm was trying to figure out what to do.
Right.
Okay. So David Tanaka says, I'm going to go through the outtakes. And we'll just find, they've shot it a bunch of times. We'll just find one that's, okay, if that was the best one,
mm-hmm.
then we'll go use the second best one, mm-hmm. right? Well, there's a problem with that. There's a reason why George picked the one that he picked, because mm-hmm. it's flawless. Everything else, there is a mistake. There's an issue. Like, the biggest one is Stormtrooper who picks up the little gasket thing, turns his head. You can see right through into the helmet and out the other side. It's really weird looking. So that's not good. Then they get together and TM Christopher's saying, people want to reshoot it. And we're like, we can't do that. That's now changing the movie. We want to add to the movie. And you can get into the weeds about what you're doing if you're changing and adding and stuff like
that.
Yeah,
yeah.
Okay, well, guess what? Tim, the guy we just talked about, the guy's the archivist, finds it. Finds it on the top shelf of the cold storage, unmarked, not anything else. Now they have it. They could start doing it.
Right.
And the first thing they have to do now is clean the film. Because remember, that's what this was.
Right.
Right? We're starting with the process. So to do that, they do a double scrub where they dip it in the chemicals and run through it.
Yeah.
They actually cut the tape where the movie's been spliced together and stuff like that. People were freaked out because if there's a mistake, you can lose the original Star Wars film and you're using the ones that's been on TV and on HBO and on the VHS and stuff like that.
Right.
But everything worked out and the range of success was 65% to 95%. So everything is cool. Now they can start the process.
Right.
So we're going to hear from Tom Kennedy again about what that process is.
We were asked to take that shot as a plate and remove the rubber puppets so that we could put computer graphics generated puppets in. So in order to do that, what we had to do was scan that, turn it into a digital file, establish what the geometry probably was, what the size of a person was, what lens they probably used, so we could build the 3D space.
Doesn't sound hard at all, does it? They're mapping existing dunes with wire mesh to build in their area so they can start very basic figures at this point.
Yeah.
Just trying to figure it all out, right?
Yeah.
It's crazy. At this point, we get introduced to the cool kid. Alex, you already know what I'm talking about, right? I believe you say his name is Alex Seaton. And we're going to meet him later vocally, but just real quick what he talks about is, well, before we can do anything, we need a good drawing. So to get a good drawing, they go to Terrell Whitlatch, the concept artist.
Yeah.
And she really thinks a lot about Dewbacks.
I had a really, really small still from a Star Wars book of the head of a Dewback. And I thought about, well, what is a Dewback like? You know, I started thinking about their personality, you know, and obviously how large they are, how heavy are they. That was pretty important, the sheer bulk of the creature. And how fast could it move?
So she's thinking about all that, plus she's thinking about what are the babies like? How long do they live? It has rhino skin. It's like a camel, so maybe the hump on the back stores fat or water to keep it going in the desert. A lot of thought into this.
I think there's too, like a lot of the camel stuff, like hearing her talk about, just the amount of things that she thought
the
about.
The calluses on the front,
just to
like
a camel.
Like,
and the feet. I think there's something with the feet, if I remember correctly.
The squishy pads.
Yeah.
Man, I don't know a lot about Dewbacks now, too.
Yeah. So, we'll be Dewback experts by the end of this.
George comes in and explains, well, like, why would you want to do Dewbacks in the desert, right? Like, why? Like, he'll right. get into that. So,
yeah, because it's a good question. Right. You know, all this technology.
Exactly. Bingo.
I wanted to give a kind of random real world feel to everything. So I wanted to do some things that weren't predictable, like having stormtroopers ride on Dewbacks. If you were to think about it very long, you would think, well, they'd be riding, you know, mechanized machines and things like that. But the idea was that there was a creature like a Dewback that existed in the desert, you know, like a lizard, that was very adaptable to the desert and was actually much better in terms of maintenance and upkeep than a machine which the sand would get into. And, you know, it was very expensive to keep those machines going out there in the middle of the desert where the Dewbacks are very cheap to run, and they last a lot longer.
He's put a lot of thought into these Dewbacks, right? That he's talking about, they're cheap, they last longer, you don't have to worry about the sand getting in. Now, that to me, stuff like the Dewbacks is what separates Star Wars from other sci-fi movies. Because a sci-fi movie would have them in a tank or a mechanized suit or something like that.
Yeah.
And they're using the creature that probably is the best way to get around that Tatooine because that's where it's from, right? So it makes a lot of sense. Now they have to create two Dewbacks because now he's getting greedy.
Yeah.
And he wants two new ones added.
Yeah.
And so they got to create two new shots before TD3. And we bring in Ted Gagliano. He's the post-production executive from 20th Century Fox.
Mm-hmm.
And his there is to give them the timestamp prints from the reel so that these guys at ILM can match up what they're doing on the new shots with the old shots. All right? Mm-hmm. But you need to remember Ted's name because he comes back again. All right? Okay. Now, from that, we go and we hear from Alex Seiden again. All right? He's the supervisor. He's the cool kid. Shoes up on the table, talking all the stuff, right?
Sunglasses dangling from his neck.
Basically, yeah, right? He's going to talk about pre-vis right now.
Pre-visualization is key to visual effects because you're dealing with a situation where a very important part of your shot doesn't exist when you shoot it. So you have to do a lot of pre-planning. You have to understand where things are going to be in, you know, spatially, and make a lot of the creative decisions that normally in live action photography you would make on the set and play around with and make them up front, because you won't be able to see what you're getting on the set, and if you don't think about that ahead of time, you can paint yourself into a big corner.
There's a lot of stuff that goes on with this, right? Because what they need to do is they use this all now, previs. Every day you hear this talk about, you hear it talking about The Mandalorian.
Mm-hmm.
And the previs in The Mandalorian was so good you can almost like use it as a cartoon if you wanted to, right?
Right.
So they're building a geometry of the Dewback to give it the front, the top, the side views. They're then taking that information and they're scanning it in 3D elements into a 3D rendering program to get all that going. And it makes it like a real set. So George explains it because it's like, this is our way of using it, of like me being on set.
When you're directing a movie and you have a cowboy on a horse and you say, okay, a little bit to the left, now, okay, now run forward. And you look at it through the camera and you say, okay, that's great, that's a rehearsal. This time, you know, come a little bit closer to the camera, start a little back, move to the left, and about halfway through, sort of rein your horse up a little bit. That's the normal way you direct. And you keep doing takes and takes until you sort of get it the way you want it to be. With computer technology and doing scenes that are basically done on a computer, you need to be able to have that same feedback in the process of creating the shot and framing the shot and deciding whether it's going too fast, too slow, too close to the camera, too far away. And that's what this whole low-res pre-visualization aspect of it is. It's a way for the director to actually see the shot, nail down the shot, and say, okay, that's the way I want it.
That what that does is it lets them go back and forth, and they show that to us, right? Like, we see a really basic skin-and-bone kind of looking Dewback, which he's got cuts on the side. Like, he's not connected. He's squishy-looking. And you can, there's a video conference and they're going back and forth about, do you like how he's walking here? Do you want, he goes, well, you know what I want to do? He goes, let's hide one behind the stormtrooper. So when the stormtrooper moves out of the way, you get a reveal of one head on coming to you.
Yeah.
So that's the first notes he sends and they do that. So having the previs to let them go back and forth really opens up everything for them to see what they want, right?
Yeah.
So again, I wasn't seeing anything about previs really in 93. You know what I'm saying? They're really getting deep into this right now, you know? So it's pretty cool. Now what happens is we need to shoot the new video, basically. Mm-hmm. Right? We need to shoot the new scenes. And it's very important to make it look like it did in 77. So we're going to hear from superstar Alex Sydan again.
All right.
One of the big challenges of dealing with the Tatooine Dune sequence was we had to match new photography with old photography. The original shot, the pan across the landscape, the stormtrooper coming up with a little gasket saying, "Look, sir, droids." The original look of all of that, we had to match that with our two new shots. We had to match the quality of the landscape. We also had to match the look of the filtration, the way the lens is flaring and the highlights look in the old shot that we had to duplicate.
How do you do that?
How do you talk like that and accentuate every single word in the sentence?
No, that's why he's the superstar, right? But how do you do that? The way you do that is by continuity reports. I didn't even know what one of those was before this.
Oh, really?
Yeah, I know. You're in the biz? You knew what it was?
Yeah, I mean.
Okay. So.
Make sure they're holding the coffee cup in the same hand that they were holding the coffee cup in.
Right.
That's
right.
Yeah.
First of all, why do they have the ability to reach out mm-hmm. and get these continuity reports? And it's a very simple reason.
George Lucas doesn't throw anything away.
I'm a pack rat.
So, he's got the continuity reports. And it's got the lens they use. It's got the focal length. It's got T-stops. I don't know what any of that stuff is. The netting. Yeah. All that stuff. Now, they can figure out how to shoot it. But now, they need stormtroopers. And they go to the archives. Mm-hmm. Why do they go to the archives again? Because...
I'm a pack rat.
All the sand troopers are there.
Yeah.
And you're like, we better use those costumes because they're going to blend better instead of creating new white plastic costumes, right? So basically, they used the stormtrooper costumes they had, and they added more backpacks to make them sand troopers, right? So we got that going. Now, you remember I told you to remember Ted Gagliano? I don't remember him anyway, so don't feel bad about that. But we're going to hear why we needed to remember this guy.
I told Rick, I guess at one point, the story of how I was always really jealous of my two best friends in high school who were friends with Ben Burtt, the Silla brothers. And I was always a step behind John Silla, who was a valedictorian of our class, and Ben recorded their voices.
All fine seer stations. All fine seer stations.
So for 20 years, it really bugged me that both of these guys got to be in Star Wars, and here I was working on it. So I told Rick about them being in it, and he said, and he called me up a few weeks later and said, "Well, what are your measurements?" And I said, "Well, 6 feet," and I really didn't know what he was. He said, "What's your weight?" And I said, "You know, 160. He said, "Well, that's, I said, you know, I started wondering, what does he ask me? He says, "Oh, that's perfect. And he goes, "Well, can you just reserve August 10th and 11th on your calendar? Are you going to be anywhere? We might just need a little, an extra stormtrooper." I said, you know, my eyes, you know, I was on the phone with him. My eyes lit up. And got stormtrooper? It's like, I said, yeah, you know, those Silla brothers, I think it's time that you put to rest this grudge that you've been carrying.
Yeah.
It's crazy.
It's really nice of them. I think if somebody was asking me, like, my measurements, my weight, I'd assume that they were going to try to fake their own death and use my body their body. But it's nice that he got put into Star Wars instead.
And that's the crazy dude himself, Rick McKellum, that was looking out for him.
Yeah.
Right?
It's just nice, like he would, like, think to remember that. But also, like, not for nothing, but, like, but you've been holding like a 20-year grudge because your friend was a voice in Star Wars. Like, just be happy for your friend, man.
Right.
I'm sure it's.
That's
like,
what I thought.
I'm sure it's like with a little bit of jest. But
so they get to Arizona. That's where they're shooting it. It's right. Brutal. It's hot. Ted, they put him up front so he won't have to walk. He's the guy holding the binoculars in the new shot, right? They got Marines to walk around the sand because Ted wasn't having it. So Ted's just standing still for most of the shoot. He makes sure his brother was there so he could have proof that he was actually in the costume. So now they're going to take those plates and match the dune geometry with the virtual set that locks the dew back to the sand.
Mm-hmm.
They go back and forth again with George to get exactly the way they want it. And now they got to talk about lighting. And here we go. Superstar Billy Graham again.
One of the things that was important to the original photography is that it had a very soft look, had that sort of gauzy, kind of rich, almost dreamy quality, pantyhose over the lens, which gives you those very distinctive four-cornered flares. If you look at the shots before they're treated with our pantyhose filter, you'll find that they're very crystal sharp, and it would be very jarring to see that kind of stuff cut in.
I just like that he says pantyhose about 1,000 times in that thing. And yeah. If you see it, you could see it if you ever watch this documentary. It is jarringly different, the new stuff that they shot.
Right.
Until they come up with the pantyhose lens that they had to come up digitally with because they weren't using it with this type of camera, right? So it's pretty crazy how they had to put this all together. Mm-hmm. But it's like really different. You could see it. It's just so... You don't get the whole... sun beating off the helmets. And, you know, besides them getting those reports, George is still alive, right? So they actually could go to the guy who shot it and said, like, what were you trying to do? He's like, I was trying to make it look extremely hot. Mm-hmm. So that's what they matched. I mean, as we've seen it, it comes out great, right? So now the lighting is done. They're going to do secondary animation, mm-hmm. which means when the Dewback puts his foot down, you'll see his belly jiggle, the tail move a little bit, that kind of stuff. So they're just putting the bells and whistles on everything. And we're going to hear from George and Alex about why they wanted to do this.
I hope the sequence now establishes that there are more stormtroopers on the planet. That it's not just two or three stormtroopers, that there's actually a lot of them. The danger is greater, and they're a more formidable element in the movie than they were before.
The important thing about the Tatooine Dune sequence was that we were trying to make a story point in that the stormtroopers weren't a bunch of lamos that just spent 5 minutes looking for the droids and didn't find them. They actually got out there and conducted a full-scale search of the planet. And to make it a little, you know, increase the dramatic tension and the stakes and give more of a sense of a wider scope to the story that's being told.
Okay, hold on.
Yep.
hold on. I just want everybody to go back and listen to that again and imagine Garth from Wayne's World as the person speaking. It's like exactly Garth from Wayne's World.
That is true. That is true.
But their point is great. And like what George was saying is like, you know, the danger is greater. But also, I think it also showcases that the importance of the droids, not that it's like ambiguous how important they are, but it makes them more important that there's more troopers out there looking
right.
for
them. This wasn't a handful of guys. This was everything they had. This is that whole thing that they sent out there. This is where we get the shuttle, which they don't talk about in here.
Right.
But the shuttle comes up.
Yep.
So you know that they're dropping guys off and stuff like that. So it's really cool. Very interesting. We got one last clip for George, and then we'll wrap this thing up.
When we decided that we would restore the films, and I realized that I had an opportunity to fix a lot of the problems that I'd had when I first finished the film. I looked at the film and began to pull all the old thorns out of my side, one of which was the Dewbacks and the fact that the Dewbacks couldn't walk, and I always wanted them to have movement and walk around and be part of the population of the film.
So yeah, I mean, that, to me, I think the Dewback was everything for him. Like, that's it. Like, he keeps talking about making him want to walk, and then after that, I'm going to pull out the next thorn, and the next thorn, and the next thorn. So I think this is the start of it all.
Yeah.
So as far as the documentary, is it a rewatchable documentary?
If you're really into, like, filmmaking and learning about that process, even though if those processes are now over 20 years old,
right.
it's worth a watch.
Right.
Beyond that, I think to a casual Star Wars fan, or maybe even a Star Wars fan that's more invested in like the story and not necessarily in like how the story's told, probably not worth a watch.
Yeah, it's not like one like, you know, the beginning from Phantom Menace. It's not like Classic Creatures that I love so much, or I know you haven't seen yet, that we're definitely doing a show on that one.
Because it's really just focused on the technical.
Yes.
Yeah.
Yes. Well, it's done well. And
what an awesome treat if you were like a savvy Star Wars fan in 1997, you were on the internet and you could check that sort of thing out.
Yes. And I mean, and we're all blessed now being introduced to Alex because he is a superstar.
Yeah, what are we up to?
A bunch of lamos.
So, where are you going?
What is that Emperor quote from?
Because it just keeps coming. I don't know.
Where are we going, Emperor? I don't know.
Oh, that was from our old special edition about the sound changes.
Oh, right, right. Oh, my gosh. Oh, my gosh. I forgot all about that.
That's a deep episode. All right, guys. You have anything else you want to add, Thor, before we get out of here?
No, that's it. I'm looking forward to the next thing, which, are we announcing what the next one is? Or
Say we do it so it holds us to it. The next one is we are going to tackle Jabba the Hutt.
Jabba the Hutt, which is probably a lot more technical talk as well, but we'll definitely have our opinions on it more so than the Dewbacks.
I think
the Dewbacks are pretty good.
Right. Jabba the Hutt's I don't know how much technical we're going to get into, because I think we're going to get into more of the story of it, talk about more of the old clip. We're going to dig that out, and we're going to play that for everybody, and we'll talk a little about how they made it. A guy named Spaz is the guy who did that. He's also the guy who did the T-Rex.
Okay.
Right? And then you look at the first job, and you're like, what happened, Spaz?
You got like that. What was that thing that Chuck Knobloch had where he couldn't throw the baseball anymore? Like, not to make light of Chuck Knobloch, but like, maybe that's what it was. I mean, I don't know. I don't fault him. It's 1997.
Right. Right. Totally. Yeah. But then again, the T-Rex came out in 93.
Yeah, but a T-Rex is a real animal. Jabba, well, that doesn't really hold any water.
There's a lot to don't give away the Jabba stuff for free. We come out for the next show. That'll be episode 4 of the special edition. We'll talk about Jabba the Hutt. So, guys, thanks so much for joining us. You can check us out on Twitter at Star Wars Cast, Instagram at BCA Podcast. You can email us at podcastbca@gmail.com. Please leave us a review on Apple or Spotify. That helps us out a lot. And if you want to support us in a different way, you can check out TeePublic. And we have a bunch of shirts and sweatshirts and stickers and all kinds of stuff. And you know what? You got to design a new logo, too, just to add on. And not that we're going to change our logo, but something from your brain. You're talented and you're an artist, so let's do something with that.
I think it's going to be me as Jabba the Hutt and you as Salacious Crumb.
I figured you just don't want to do back, but all right, we'll go from there. So until next week, guys, thanks so much. Why don't you say goodbye, Thor?
Goodbye, everybody.
All right, guys, go make some droids. Rudimental. Yeah. Basic. All right, I'll go back. We see a basic